AWS Loft Talks.
My name is Justin Lundy. I'm the co-founder, CIO, and CTO of Evident.io. Excited to be here. The agenda for my brief talk today is really to skim over the shared responsibility model because it seems like most people here are going to be familiar with that at this point, and also to cover what I would consider the top 10 AWS security best practices based on the experience of our team and what we've seen operating some of the largest Amazon infrastructures out there. So I'm sure everyone is familiar with the Amazon shared security model. How many people here feel they're comfortable with the shared responsibility model, know what they're on the hook for versus what Amazon's on the hook for? Can I show hands, anyone? Okay, good. Two-thirds of the audience. So we're going to skip this. Number one, disable root account API access key. So one of the reasons why you want to disable that is because you cannot restrict what that API key has the ability to do on Amazon. What you would prefer to do, what you should be doing, is limit your key usage to a restricted role, and that role has a policy that restricts its ability to perform actions against the Amazon API. So in the unfortunate and unlikely event that a developer mistakenly uploads your keys to GitHub or some other public source, the damage is limited. The potential for damage is limited. So additionally, I've heard of a few examples where companies will outsource their Amazon management to a company, and the company that they outsource their management to just so happened to use root API keys for all of their 60 developers. And they didn't create any individual accounts for individual users or restrict any other policy. So that's just an accident waiting to happen, and you don't want that to be your organization. Additionally, I'll touch on MFA later on, but you want to make sure to set up MFA on your root account. And one of the things that a lot of our friends and colleagues do is they'll set up MFA on the root account and then they'll literally throw away the key so it's unusable. And the people in your organization are required to use IAM users and roles to make any changes to your infrastructure. Number two, enable MFA tokens everywhere. So that means for everyone from your root user to all of your IAM users. And why do you want to do this? Because drive-by downloads are pretty popular. Browser-based attacks are pretty common these days. And in a nutshell, an attacker can phish you and put up a page that looks like the Amazon login page and convince you to cough up your credentials. But if you had turned on MFA and were requiring MFA, they would need to have your MFA token to actually use those credentials. So a great reason to use MFA. Number three, reduce the number of IAM users you have with administrative privileges. That means everyone in your development organization or your DevOps organization does not need full-blown, unrestricted access to the Amazon API. If you have a particular team that's managing your EC2 infrastructure, and perhaps you have a separate DBA group managing your RDS instances, set up policy that your DBAs can only touch RDS, and set up a policy so that the folks managing EC2 can only manage the EC2 instances, and so on and so forth. Number four, using roles for EC2 is another great practice. The reason for this is you don't have your Amazon keys sitting on the local disk of your EC2 instance when it's running in the cloud. And why is that a potential problem? And this is another case where you're taking an action to limit the potential damage that could occur in the event that a system were compromised. So, for example, if you're using roles for EC2, the Amazon system itself is able to pass the correct credentials for that role to the instance, so the Amazon SDK, when you're making any API calls to the Amazon API, knows the credentials that are assigned to it. So you're not having to leave keys on disk. And when you do that, essentially, there are no keys to steal. So if an attacker were to break into your system in the unlikely event that they were able to get on your disk and start digging around through your data, there would be no Amazon keys to find anywhere. Number five, least privilege. It's similar to what I talked about a little bit earlier about making sure your IAM users have restricted policies. But when you do this, you need to make sure that you're following that for all of the workflows that you have. So least privilege applies to not just EC2 instances and the servers in your EC2 fleet, but it applies to S3, and it applies to your Elastic Cache clusters, and it applies to how you're passing data into Glacier for backup and so on and so forth. So you need to keep the concept of least privilege in mind throughout the list of services that Amazon makes available to its customer base. A lot of folks make the mistake of just thinking about least privilege within their servers within EC2. And there's a lot more capability in the Amazon platform for you to restrict these abilities and restrict privileges across a large number of services, not just EC2. Number six, this is another great one. Another example where you're going to limit any potential damage that can occur if a breach were to take place, unfortunately. You would be surprised at the number of people that never rotate their keys. And this is a huge problem because in the event that your keys were to ever be exposed, wouldn't you want to make sure that your keys were being rotated every 90 days at a minimum, or every 60 or every 30? Some of our customers are doing it more frequently than that. But the intention is that if a key were ever to be leaked, you do not want that key to be valid for very long. Number seven, use IAM roles with STS Assume Role. So this is great. If you have a third-party provider that you're working with who is helping you manage or secure your Amazon infrastructure, you do not want to give them your API keys. What you want to do is use IAM roles and assume roles so that your third-party provider can make API calls against the Amazon API and assume your role, and that role that you give them is restricted by you, so you can control what they do and don't have access to. And in the event that you don't want that provider to have access to your infrastructure anymore, you simply need to remove the role, and you don't have a key management issue to worry about in terms of giving them keys and worrying about key rotation and so on and so forth. Beyond that, using identity federation is another thing that a lot of folks should consider in Amazon. It depends on your organization size. For a lot of small to mid-sized businesses and startups, it may or may not make sense to do a full-blown federated identity rollout, but we've seen small companies do it in addition to large enterprises. Number eight, how many people here have ever experienced a DDoS attack anywhere? Oh, wow, that's about 20 people, that's huge, okay. One of the things that we found was that we can absorb a DDoS attack using Amazon, basically. So by having our web tier configured for auto-scaling, in the event where a bunch of nasty traffic gets sent to your web servers, your fleet auto-scales up. And generally speaking, in the event of a DDoS attack, if your infrastructure is taking the attacker's going to give up after a while, because the whole point of a DDoS attack is to deny service to your customers. So we found that in cases where we didn't have auto-scaling in place and a DDoS attack happened, the system would go down, and sometimes these DDoS attacks would persist for weeks, and it was nasty to deal with. However, in cases where we had auto-scaling in place, the attackers would give up after a while because, in effect, their attack was not effective at all. So they would just give up and move on to the next site serving cat pictures. Number nine, do not allow all in security groups. I can't tell you how many people we've seen that they'll leave services wide open to the entire internet IP address space that should be restricted to a single IP address of a single management system for someone on their DevOps team, for example. And that's not just security groups on your EC2 instances. You need to keep in mind the security groups for all of the other services out there. If you're using EMR, what about your security groups there? If you're using RDS or Elastic Cache or Elastic Load Balancer, so on and so forth, you need to keep an eye on your security groups across all of those various services. And it's important to make sure that you're limiting access to only the systems that need the ability to communicate with the system that you're configuring a security group for. Amazon does a good job of having a default deny, but if you launch templates and you're using a bunch of free open source code, a lot of the time they open up more than you might realize if you're not keeping a close eye on it. So number 10, this is another good one. A lot of folks make the mistake of not keeping an eye on their S3 configuration, how they've configured their buckets, their bucket ACLs, or their bucket policies. And the reason why this is important is because there are a lot of occasions out there where a newbie or a junior administrator simply clicks the wrong button in the S3 UI, and then all of a sudden that S3 bucket that has critical customer data in it is exposed to the entire internet, and you have a nasty problem to deal with. So in this case, it's incredibly important to keep an eye on any S3 buckets that you know contain sensitive information or information that's not public and should never be exposed.
AWS Loft Talks.